my name is Sidra360, and I do pony art and pony accessories, and I'm listening to that show.
Close enough.
Hello and welcome to the MBS Show, episode number 143. I am your host, Norman Sanzo. Joining me today is James Carl.
It's early. It's only 4:44 in the afternoon. Let me go back to sleep, Mom.
No, you have a job to do.
No, I don't have. You don't pay me.
I pay you in magic cards.
Okay, fair enough. Damn it.
Yes. So how have you been, James?
I've been fine. It's wonderful to be back to the normal show, you know, after like being disappeared for several weeks. Only appearing in the review episodes and nothing else. Yeah, it's like, oh my god, where did I go? I have no idea.
It's cool,
I went
man.
To places.
Life sometimes gets in the way, but it's cool. Like, Ro here backs me up sometimes, or even if we don't have a guest, we'll just dip around.
A life, commissions, a freight train, anything gets in the way, yeah.
Mm-hmm. True that.
It's a long story.
Yeah. No one wants to listen to us nag about our life. So let's move on to the next person online is Rom.
Hello, all you happy people.
Hey there, Rom. How are you doing, man?
I am alive!
I heard you had an awesome night yesterday.
It was a party, man. It was a party. So many awesome people left and right.
Mm-hmm. So I heard you did some kind of commission or...
Yeah, I tossed a request stream. You know, people can come in, ask for a picture, and I could draw it for them. And I did. And we had loads of fun.
Wow, that is cool, man. That is cool. Who came, if you can remember?
I had Luna Bagel. I had Celestia stuff. I had a few other new pony ass blocks I didn't know about, but now I do.
Oh,
yeah,
awesome.
Had fun times. Oh, and Palette Swaps was there, too.
Oh, man, awesome. Congrats, man. Congrats.
Palette is brilliant.
Indeed. But she came right to the end of the stream, just as I was about to end it.
Oh.
Wow, that's the problem with time zones sometimes, you know.
I was streaming for 9 hours straight. I ended at 5 in the morning.
Oh my. Talking about time zones and whatnot, our guest for this week is Citra360.
Oh, wait, no, I'm Atrial. You were trying to get Citra360?
Oh!
Done!
Oh.
I'm not even sure if I have the same voice as him. You know, funny enough, at BronyCon, some French interviewers was interviewing Atrial live first, and then I was right after Atrial. It's just the order of sequence is the exact same. I'm always after Atrial, apparently.
Oh, wow.
Not a bad act to follow.
Yeah, but you guys are awesome.
Talent is immediately followed with even more talent, so he's like, wow, look at that.
Anyways, yeah, jokes aside, I'm Citra. Or T-Citra.
Yeah, welcome to the show, man. Welcome to the show. It's an honor to have you on the show. It's awesome to speak to you, man. Like, the pre-show was already full of, how do I say, derpiness and full of awesomeness at the same time. I wish I...
So it's a bit of a blend of derpy and Rainbow Dash.
True that. Oh, man, I can't believe I'm going to say this joke, but it's just 20% more derpy.
Norman, get out. You're not doing a good job.
Yeah, it's been a while. But anyway, welcome to the show. So how are you, Isra? How are you doing, Isra?
Staying busy, and when I'm not busy, I try to be busy. Just trying to keep things moving forward and ideas made and projects finished. I have several projects going on. I may have to stop one and finish the other. Just gotta get things moving.
That's a good philosophy, keeping yourself busy just to improve yourself and move on, I guess, or improve yourself at the same time.
Yep, though I do relax every now and then. I don't like I must draw every day. No.
If you do that, you're gonna go insane, and nobody loves an insane guy.
Or hey, do they?
You got me on the show.
Yep.
But you got me as well, Norman. What the hell? We're going to have a talk, you and I, later on.
Yeah, true that. But anywho...
You're in trouble, young man.
Oh, yes, boss. But anywho, Citra, before we move on, I need to ask you the four important questions. And question number one is, favorite character?
Applejack.
Applejack? Wow. Why Applejack?
She's down to earth, she hard works, and she just gets everything done through experience and labor.
Hmm. That's rare. I mean, personally for me, I don't hear a lot of Applejacks, and well, most of what they say is Applejack is the best background pony.
Oh, Norman, you are so 2012.
I'm just telling people, I'm not saying anything.
It's always funny whenever I tag the characters in my artwork and I have everybody in it. And I'm like, on Tumblr, I'm like, okay, Rainbow Dash, Applejack. No, it's not like this. It's like Rainbow Dash, Pinkie Pie, Twilight, Rarity, Fluttershy, Twilight. Who did I miss? How did I forget Applejack? It's like, it's whenever that happens. But I find that funny that she's considered a background character just because she doesn't have enough roles in the show. Well, technically, I think she has pretty good balance. It's just a funny joke.
True, and also I think she doesn't have enough problems to make her front and center.
Though Rarity never had an episode in season 3.
That is true. But the one thing is that Applejack doesn't need to have outlandish problems for her to be a good character in it. She is so grounded in reality that all of her problems are grounded in reality as well.
Mm-hmm. Probably could be that.
Yeah. By the way, you are not. Citra, Applejack is my second favorite right after Rarity, but they are kind of tied at this moment. They are both equally good.
Well, ship them.
I don't ship them.
Okay.
When I ship, it's with UPS.
Yay.
I prefer FedEx. Actually, no, I never use FedEx because I'm not American.
Oh. No, the best ship is FedEx UPS. Those two are wonderful together. Mm-hmm. I've never seen those two as personified before. I need to do that. Anyways.
Looks like we might see something in the future. Yay! So, second question is, favorite episode?
Favorite episode, that's a bit of a tie. It could be my very first episode, Bridal Gossip. That's the one I've seen for the very first time. The very first episode I've ever seen. That's the one where they're trying to figure out who Sakura is and are being all superstitious about her. And that's when Applejack was tiny, Fluttershy, had a manly voice, which ultimately confused me. I paused the episode and I was like looking at her very detailed. I'm like, how is this a guy? And I didn't really. And then I just shrugged and went along with it. And it was only until the very end of the episode when her voice turned back to normal. I was like, oh, she wasn't a guy. It was a joke. Okay. So right in the very beginning, I thought Fluttershy really was some sort of feministic looking guy.
Wow.
And I guess if it's not my first episode, it has to be testing 1, 2, 3. That's a very good episode. Then again, I like Twilight and Rainbow Dash.
Yeah.
Anyways.
The third question is, how did you become a fan of the show?
It was probably March 2011. I was randomly browsing YouTube for animated music videos, like, you know, people do with PMVs. They put different clips together with music. Though this was like random cartoons and movies, like different Disney and DreamWorks show, and they put it with music. So it was similar things, and I saw it was under like suggested for you from YouTube at the time. And I saw a thumbnail of My Little Pony, and I was like, that don't look like the 90s My Little Pony. What is that? So I watched the animated music video, or my very first PMV, mm-hmm. and I was like, well, that was interesting. And I was like, let me see, what's the name of this show? And I looked it up, and I found Bridal Gossip on YouTube, and I laughed. I was like, that was funny. So I looked for the first episode, and I just watched it straight from that episode all the way to when to wrap up. That was the only episodes at the time. I was like, that was pretty funny. I like it. And then I did a live stream with my DeviantArt, and I was drawing random cartoon characters from different shows. It was sketched up in the very bottom left corner. I drew Rainbow Dash and uploaded it, and everybody in the comments was like, "Ah, oh, Rainbow Dash! Ah, oh, welcome to the herd, brohood!" I'm like, "Who are you people?" And that's when I found out what bronies are, and I was completely oblivious to it beforehand. And I just started drawing it more and more, and I was like, I like this. And that's how I became a fan, just by random on YouTube and people saying, welcome to the herd on on DeviantArt without even me saying I am a brony. Just outright, welcome to the herd.
Okay, that's cool.
You had a SpongeBob from SpongeBob SquarePants Patrick moment right there. When he arrives to his house, he's surrounded by eyes, and you're like, where do you people keep coming from?
Yeah, it was funny.
It is funny because there are so many artists that start in this fandom with drawing Rainbow Dash. Like I know John Joseco started with Rainbow Dash as well. I started with doing a picture of Rainbow Dash. You started with a picture of Rainbow Dash. Yeah, it seems the character to go to when you want to start in this fandom.
It feels like the Pony 101 character to begin with.
Yeah, true.
Because she's the most... She has the most color, so she stands out the most, and so people are like, I'll draw her first.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. And then, after you draw her like 3 or 4 times, you are like, I hate drawing your mane, I hate these many colors, why do you have so many hues in your stupid mane? Oh my...
It's real time consuming getting your hair done, but it's really worth it at the end. I really love drawing hair.
It's cool. So, what do your family and friends think about your love for the show?
Some of them watches it now too.
Ooh, wow!
Though not like brownie level, but when I first watched when I saw my first episode, the next hour, my sister came home from school. I'm like, sister, watch this. And then that night, my family came from their work, and I'm like, family, watch this. Next day, cousins, watch this. The day after that, friends, watch this. Next week, random stranger on the street, watch this. I didn't care that I was watching ponies, or it was like stereotypically meant for girls. I didn't care at all, so I just was sharing it to everybody.
Oh, that's awesome. So, how many people have you converted to the herd?
We have a lot of my DeviantArt original fans, including Toxic Mario, if you recognize him.
Yep.
We
know Tox.
I guess I semi-helped one of the comic artists that moved on. I can't remember his name. Veggie55, there we go.
Oh, yeah, him.
Veggie55. Yeah, he says he saw it a little bit before I got into it, but it's interesting we all got into it at the same time.
Mm. All right.
Yeah. I support anyone who moves on like Vinci did, because we all have a life.
Oh, that's true.
We want to do things outside of this fandom, believe it or not.
Yeah. I'm inspired to become a pro magic player, but I'm terrible at the game.
I have a novel in the works, but
that's true.
I have nothing to do at all.
The only card game I ever played was Pokemon, and that was when I was a kid. Although I still have like all my basic sets in my closet. Actually, it was my dad who got me into Pokemon. We were at a tournament in the city at the time. I was 8, and we were watching a couple of kids play a match. And he's like, and then my dad brought me into a card shop, and he bought me a basic pack. He's like, son, I want you to learn strategy. I want you to learn how to think. Here's a Pokemon card set. I'm like, okay.
Your father is awesome.
So wait, he's awesome, but did you learn anything from that?
Yeah, I did. My grades actually improved. Wow. Thank you, Pokemon.
Awesome. Now go play X and Y.
That is scientifically proven, is that video games and strategy games can help you improve the way of thinking and solving problems. Mm-hmm. That is actually a very clever way to exercise the brain of a little kid. That is very, very clever. Mm-hmm. Kudos to your dad.
Yep, yep.
He knew what he was doing.
True that.
Yeah, I'm very thankful to my family. They're very supportive. And even in all of this, like, they're trying to help me think up some ways to continue my career. Or if I'm running behind on creating merchandise for my convention shows, like my buttons, mm-hmm. they will, like, force me to go to bed and make the buttons themselves. Oh, wow. So I don't be too tired for driving the next day.
Oh, that's awesome. That is awesome.
Very good.
That is a really supportive family. And, yeah, kudos, man. That is really awesome.
Yep.
Well, 4 questions has been answered and the floodgates have been opened, so I guess it's time to go to the next topic, and next topic is guest time. So, Citra, mind introducing yourself to the people who might not know who you are and what you do?
I draw ponies. Yeah, I'm an illustrator, freelance artist. I do some graphic design work. like for Wheel of Fine, mm-hmm. that, you know, the online shirt apparel company. Mm-hmm. So you find my designs on there. They're licensed by Hasbro, so that's very awesome.
Thank you.
I haven't done that for a while. I would like to get back into doing designs for Wheel of Fine again, except for, you know, other licenses. See where I can go with that and push more designs out there, because I really need to do that. And I'm always coming up with new ideas to draw characters in. So if you watch my gallery, my Tumblr, my Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, though most of them in my Tumblr will have my artwork. You'll find definitely a variety of artwork being pushed there, because I don't draw the same thing once over and over again. I tend to draw the characters in different ways each time, always experimenting with different styles. Like recently I'm experimenting with oil types. Maybe next week I'll stop. Do minimalism. It always changes.
Okay, that's cool. And seeing that you're working with other material or other things, I noticed that you have a Prismacolor premiere. Is that?
Oh yeah, just recently. Yeah, last night. Yesterday, a set of Prismacolor markers arrived. I never got markers before because they're always expensive, but I was during like Black Friday sales here in the United States, and I was like, oh wow, this $300 set is for $120. I'll buy it right now. I better get it now. Though I could have got a $800 set for $400, but I was thinking, I've never done Prismacolors before, so I better just get a smaller set first. Though it's very interesting, the Prismacolors. I never used them before, and how they blend together. I never seen that happen. I always used cheap markers from Crayola when I was a kid, and I never seen things blend like Prismacolors do. And I'm just saying it's just opening up a new world of possibilities for me now.
Yay! Awesome. So this Prismacolors, is it the same kind of material that Copic use?
Technically, but they're different companies. They're competing, and they probably have different formulas. Though I heard Copic doesn't have as much alcohol smell as Prismacolor does, even though it didn't really bother me. I noticed it, and I guess Prismacolor has some different features. Like it has it's a paint thinner, but they call it a color blender. You can lift off some marker paint off the paper, which I'm like, really? You can do that? And I don't have the marker with me, but it'd be interesting to have that to fix any mistakes. Like, on my first one, I did go outside the line time to time, embarrassingly.
Oh, it's cool, it's cool. That first one you did was the Rainbow Dash one, right?
Naturally. As we mentioned earlier.
I'm looking at it right now, and oh my god, that looks so vibrant.
And use some color pencils on top of it to bring the brighten up the blues.
That is cool. Wow. That's cool.
I watched some tutorials on Prismacolors before I started that, about 8 of them. And a few of them mentioned not to outline your shadows. It will create a visible outline, even if you try to shade it and blend them in. So, and I was like, that's a good tip. So I never did it.
All right. So, how long have you been doing art or drawing?
10 years.
10 years?
I reached a decade. I started when I was a freshman in high school. I actually was forced to take art class as a curriculum. And I was like, I don't want to draw art. I suck at art. I don't want to do art. I will never like to do art. And then I took the class, and I'm like, I love art. I love drawing. I love to draw. Though I sucked at the time. I didn't start getting better until like my fourth or fifth year drawing.
Okay, that's cool. That's cool.
I'm still learning.
That is cool. And what did your teachers at the time say about your improvement?
Oh, my teacher loved my progress and how intrigued I am with art and how much I would draw in class and all the amount of effort I put in my artwork when I submit my homework. And she even started a series where we take the ceiling tiles, it's pretty big ceiling tiles, and we paint on it. So I was had the privilege to paint the first ceiling tile, and I drew a landscape, painted a landscape. Though looking back now, I could have done a lot better.
Everyone has to start somewhere.
And then the next semester, she invited a couple more students from her class to do it. So every semester, a couple more students do a ceiling tile. I'm like, oh, this is awesome. And then my sister got into the high school, and then she was able to draw a ceiling tile too. And I'm like, this is very awesome. When I try, like, when I'm a kid someday, and we'll go to the art class, I'm like, see that ceiling tile right there? I painted that. Unfortunately, there was a terrible event happened in town. A personal airplane crashed right into the school. And then the section it crashed into and burned was the had the art class, so my artwork that artwork is gone forever. But it's so unfortunate for that family. The whole town.
You think it was a conspiracy to destroy the evidence of the artwork or something like that?
Nah, but I still remember that day. I was drawing in my house, and I thought a ladder fell outside. I looked outside saying, no, there's no ladder. It fell outside. That's when I found out the plane hit the school.
Wow. Yeah,
everybody in town heard it, and the closest house that was nearby thought it was an earthquake because it just rattled the whole home.
Oh, my.
Anyways, yeah, that's a sad event.
Wow. Oh, man, that is shocking. That is shocking.
Our town, really even though we have our town is so small, smaller than Bronycon, we tend to hit news, worldwide news, every now and then in school.
To go back to what you mentioned about being with Will of Fine and having a partnership with them, how is the whole process of you made the picture... And then, from the picture to getting it on the T-shirt, what are the steps that you have to follow?
So let's see. It's artist draw design, artist submit design. Wheel of Fine gets design. Wheel of Fine submits to Hasbro. Hasbro gets design. They say yay or nay. They send back to Wheel of Fine. Wheel of Fine sends back to artists with either suggestions for changes or approvements. Or acceptance. And once that happens, design goes on store. Fan, artist, buys design. Design gets shipped to fan. Fan is happy.
And at the same time, artists get cut off profit, right?
Yeah, for licensed artwork, it's a 10% cut. So the more sales I get, the better it is.
Mm-hmm. That is actually not bad. That is actually a good percentage.
Yeah, so far I had two designs of Hasbro, DreamWorks, Disney. Though DreamWorks and Disney is just one design. Oh. And it takes a while for some designs to go through. Though Hasbro is pretty quick. Though I have a couple designs that's in approval for the last 2 months. So we're trying to figure out what's up with Hasbro. I think it's mostly because of Equestria Girls. There's a lot of push on that normal merchandise is getting a little bit of a lag. So I'm expecting my designs to be approved any moment now. Too bad I wasn't around during Black Friday.
That is kind of sad. But would you say there is a lot of executive meddling when it comes to the designs? Like, have you ever felt like Hasbro was sticking their fingers too much into the stuff that you were drawing? Or are they actually as lenient
Lenient. You people would be surprised because, you know, like the cease and desist orders and all that. That's a different department. This is approving for official merchandise, and they're very lenient to what people do to their license. Like, I drew the characters as robots. They accepted it.
Mm-hmm, that's cool.
Or my cyborg one, they have weapons on their arms, and they accepted it.
Oh, wow.
Which is surprising. But where Disney, my Wreck-It Ralph design, I was creating that when it was in theaters, and it didn't get approved until it was out on DVD. They only had, specific poses they approved. They only accepted, a certain thickness of line artwork. I mean, I had an idea of having all the characters busting through a brick wall on a red T-shirt. They said, no. I'm like, okay. But well, I was able to create something they like, and I'm still selling Wreck-It Ralph t-shirts today, so that movie's awesome enough for that to happen, so it's all good.
Well, it's one of those timeless classics. My question comes more influenced by the fact that everybody that works with Hasbro, from the comic book artists and writers to the writers for the show, they always say, oh no, it's very easy to work with them, they are very open, they are very open-minded, and I always think, cynical me, well, that's because they have them on the paycheck. They better be saying that, or else out you go up the door. But then, coming from an artist who's also as close to the fandom as to his working with Hasbro, it kind of like carries a bit more weight, if you know what I mean. So, yeah, it's like, I like to think that Hasbro is that open. It is good to know that they are that open.
Oh, yeah, it's very crazy how awesome the company is when it comes with their license. Even with the whole season desist stuff, they're still doing a lot better compared to other companies. it's just, you know, since it's our fandom, it's our fans and how awesome the content we curate, it just affects us a lot more personally than, you know, what we see in other fandoms, because we don't notice it happening because we're not in those fandoms.
It is very easy to vilify the company when I am pretty sure that they are the first ones suffering for, like, look at this guy, he's doing so much awesome stuff. Do we really need to send him a cease and desist? Yeah, we have to. Aww. Damn it.
During the whole button smash fiasco with Jan Animations, I concepted two characters, like Flim and Flam, except they're all like lawyer-looking ponies. I call them Cease and Desist.
Oh god, no!
Cease and Desist.
If I ever play around with the idea, if I use like a comic on that, at the very end of the comic's like, and you cannot use our likeness as ponies. We shall cease and desist ourselves.
Oh god.
He's a cease with the awesome C&D brothers.
Oh god, no.
You cannot make the content that you like to really make, even though you're fans. We have to investigate.
Oh, off the cuff, that's awesome.
We are pony lawyers, non parle.
And by the way, audience, this is not scripted. I wish this was so I can join in, but oh god, this is so
awesome.
It's
getting recorded. It's getting recorded. It's fine.
Any musicians listening in, you guys got to create an original song about this.
Yay, do it!
or maybe a spoof on Flim and Flam's Super Nut Cider song.
true.
I have a couple of musician friends. I have to poke them with this idea because this is gold.
If they do that, I can draw the artwork for them.
Yay!
Yes! That would be great.
Citra, you mentioned earlier that sometimes when Hasbro wants to push something, they'll say, oh, we want to push this more. Do they come to you and say, or do Wheel of Fine come to you and say that, hey, could you create something for Equestria Girls? Do they do that to you?
I got approached to make something before, and it wasn't Equestria Girls. It was actually when Twilight was becoming an Alicorn. A princess. I knew about it about 6 months before it even became a rumor.
Oh boy.
And everybody was like saying, oh, is Twilight going to get wings? I'm like, maybe. or I already had my design ready, my t-shirt design, before people started drawing her with wings as a canon. And people's like, are you going to draw Twilight with wings? And I have like, I'm just looking off to the side of my design that's all finished and she has wings. I'm like, maybe. I was under my first cease and desist.
No, it's cease and desist. It's, what should we call this?
Non-divulgation clause.
NDA.
NDA.
Non-disclosure agreement form. I was under my first NDA. I'm like, yes.
I'm going somewhere.
I'm told not to talk about this.
That is awesome, seriously. That is awesome. Wow. So, I'm looking through Wheel of Fine right now and looking at all the shirts that you did. I love some of this. I wish that Wheel of Fine has a wish list so that I can just put it there, so if it goes on a discount, I can buy it, because the ones that I like, it's men's muffins. I like that one.
That came from just a doodle on my sketchbook, and I'm like, I like that, so I just finished it as a t-shirt design. I already actually have the original sketch here.
So, talking about merchandising, have you ever thought about bringing your designs to other places like Redbubble or wherever that do the same thing?
Well, the thing is that you still pretty much earn only 10%. Redbubble and those other places take a huge cut. And second, you're not really making official merchandise. You know, that's the benefit with Wheel of Fun. I get to say that's official merchandise. And third, the competition in those other places is vastly bigger than the other artists on Wheel of Fine. Plus, you have the marketing push of Wheel of Fine in itself. Redbubble, you just pretty much have to hope they like you. And you pretty much have to be successful based on your own, basically just on your own fan base. I had a lot of people who bought my artwork or my t-shirts on Wheel of Fine, and they come to my table at a convention. It's like, oh, you made this? I love it. They don't even realize it. Where, you know, Redbubble, I don't think people really search for specific t-shirts. They pretty much go there through links through artist pages because they're already a fan. So that's just the bonus of Wheel of Fine and the disadvantage of Redbubble. Though the only advantage there is getting t-shirts on the stores faster in case something like right now that's happening where Hasbro's taking their time with approving the t-shirt. With Redbubble, they don't care because they're not Hasbro.
Oh, so basically there's the NDA stuff. Like, for example, like you said earlier, oh, I know Twilight's going to have wings. So if you put it up on Redbubble, like, we don't care. It's going to sell.
Honestly, I have no idea how Redbubble can get away with all those sales. You know, that's very obviously they're selling My Little Pony stuff without the license. So I don't know how that happens.
Yeah, and I don't know legal, so let's not touch that.
No, I'm not angry at anybody who uses Redbubble. No.
It's an option.
Yeah, some cool designs come from there. Like, my favorite is the Applejack shirt that's literally spoofing the cereal Applejacks.
Oh, yeah, that one. Yeah, I love that one.
Yeah.
That artist is great. That one? It's one of those designs I'm like, it's so simple, yet why did I not draw it first? And here I'm, here I'm marketing someone else.
It's cool. Yeah. So, Jinx?
Yeah, like, when you mentioned that they are trying to push more for Equestria Girls right now, if, for example, you go to them with the design of Coco Pomel, for example, that was super popular at the beginning of the year, since it was the first episode that we had of Friendship is Magic in 2014, and you go to them with that, and they say, oh, yeah, you know, that's not very popular right now, people are going crazy for Sonata Dusk, can you draw something with Sonata Dusk in it?
Well, it's not really... Hasbro is telling me this, but more like Wheel of Fun. They see what's like trending and like saying Derpy is trending right now, or Doctor Who is trending right now, or Rainbow Dash is in. They have stuff like that they can tell us. Though right now it's definitely a big push on other licenses. Like I've seen they're doing a lot of video game t-shirt designs, which I'm at a disadvantage of because I hardly play games. So I'm like. Like I did not know what Dota was until I started making shirts for it.
I still don't know what Dota is, and I don't think I want to care.
I don't Dota, I get a scene of Dota.
Trust me, you don't. You're not missing out on anything.
That's almost awesome.
I want to watch Kill la Kill, that is for sure, but I don't care for Dota.
Kill la Kill is definitely a win. You're not going to lose anything with that.
What is the most difficult part for you when you make a drawing? The sketching, the inking, the coloring, the shading, the background, the proportions, the perspective. What is the one part that you look at and you say, ugh, here we go?
I say sketching because you pretty much have to lay down the idea, the posing right off the back, And I'm always like, oh, no, this pose don't look good. No, this pose don't look good. I didn't want the head a little bit higher. No, the eye needs to be lower down, that kind of stuff. And I'm like thinking about the composition, the arrangement of the elements inside of the painting. So I'm always like using the lasso tool on my sketch and moving the things around, trying to get it looking right. And once I finally get the sketch done, then I relax, because the rest of the drawing is just pretty much routine. And I just like start lining, or if it's not a line art, I just start shading, and I just can't. And then it's really relaxing for me when I start shading and coloring, because my mind just starts thinking about color theory and like which colors will go good here. And that's not stressful for me at all. I actually enjoy that. And like right now, I'm redoing one of my very first Fluttershy drawings. I'm taking my time on it. And like I was drawing the grass, thinking about the shadows, the lighting, where I want the elements to be in. And I realized like 5 hours passes easily. I'm like, oh, it's already 5 hours? So it doesn't feel like I'm taking a long time. It's just very easy going once I get past the sketch stage.
Yeah, so basically you're saying that the part of the drawing that worries you the most is the blueprint and the base that the entire drawing is going to have. So basically the most important part of the drawing, really. That is a very rational fear. Because if you don't have a good sketch, the drawing is pretty much doomed.
True that.
So it's you said that you use the lasso tool. I am going to deduce from that you use Photoshop.
Yeah, Photoshop is my main drawing program, though I used Sketchbook Pro, Illustrator, and Corel Painter before. I need to use Corel Painter more. It seems like coloring and shading on that works for me a lot more. But I use Photoshop mostly.
Yeah, okay. You say you might be one of the first artists that we have here that uses Photoshop, aside from me. Because I am always like, I use Photoshop CS5, and it's like, I feel so alone.
Talk to a lot of Sai artists?
Yes. Pretty much every single person that we have interviewed, they use Paint Tool Sai.
But most of it all depends on each artist, and each program could have its own specialty or advantage compared to the others. But, you know, a lot of artists use Sai because of the stabilization of the line strokes. People like mm-hmm. that. Though I can have that in Sketchbook as well, but I don't use stabilization. I don't know. It feels like it's hindering my lines. And I learned how to do line art on traditional paper, and that carried over to my digital canvas. And I'm able to do a full line work on a comic page in Photoshop, and it looked just like anybody else's. I even did a line tutorial on YouTube explaining how to do it.
Oh, cool. I actually know. I know how you feel on that. I don't use stabilizers either. I have no idea how to use that. I need my hand to be completely free when drawing. I cannot imagine how is that.
Well, there's nothing wrong using it, but it could easily be a crutch to an artist if they depended on too much. And also on the other end, it could be actually used as a stylistic tool, like. It could be used for a style. I notice people who use a stabilization tool, their line artworks tend to have the same look to them each time. And sometimes that style may be useful to the artist. So it depends.
I don't... I can totally see that. But you also run the risk of making every single one of your picture a clone of each other. So it's like... Or don't make them look lively enough. Or like... dynamic enough, if you know what I mean.
I definitely know what you mean.
Yeah. Right. Not ditching the people that like to use stabilizers for their art. More power to them. I just don't see it. It doesn't matter.
So, Citra, I'm looking at one of your pictures on the Tumblr's blogs, yeah, and you mentioned about doing live streams, and I noticed here that you are going to use the iPhone 6 to use for streaming?
Oh yeah, I've done that already. It was I have this stand that I use for mobile devices. I use it for many things, and I was like, hey, I can use that to prop my phone or my tablet up and use a webcam for doing traditional art streams. And then I just AirPlay it, the screen from my phone onto my computer using a third-party program. But lately, for some reason, it lags. I'm not sure if it's the new operating system on the phone, if it's the program on my computer, or it's my router, because it has to go through Wi-Fi. And I feel like it's my router. I've been having issues with it. So I haven't been doing traditional art streams lately because of that. So recently I bought a webcam, a Logitech webcam. It'll be coming Monday. Maybe by next week I'll be having traditional art streams again. Though I'll still probably use my phone and prop it up over my drawing alongside my webcam because I'm loving the time lapse feature on the camera. That's the new feature. I'm like, oh, that's useful. I'll just hit record over the time lapse and it'll automatically speed up my video for me, and I don't have to have like 3-5 gigabytes of footage recordings of my drawings and eat up my hard drive and saves me a step when I want to submit a time lapse video on YouTube.
Okay, that's cool. So, how long have you been doing this method of recording or this method of streaming?
Probably over a year and a half ago, I started doing something like that. I even went silly with my computer. I even tried using my iMac as my webcam to draw on. I have a crazy arm on my desk that props my iMac up, and I can literally push it where it's like parallel with my desk with a screen pointing down and lift it up in midair.
I did that with Lionheart to play Magic. it was awkward to see my screen, but yeah, we had a game.
Yeah, though I probably going to get a new computer here soon. It will be lighter since, you know, computers progress over time.
True that. I think you're the first guest that do a lot of traditional art in terms of streaming and beyond. So do you do traditional art for practice, or is that one of your mainstays?
I'm trying to get back into it. I started with traditional art before digital art for about 3-4 years before I touched a digital canvas. In fact, my first digital art piece was a horse, photo referenced, and I didn't know what a tablet was. I thought digital art was done with a mouse, so I did the whole thing with a mouse, and it came out pretty cool. Surprisingly, it looked pretty photorealistic, though it did help having a photo, and I copied a photo. Though, I wonder if I can find a link and show you guys. But yeah, my first digital piece was with a mouse, and then over time, like, oh, I can get a tablet and help me on that.
Yay! Life is getting easier.
Let's see if DeviantArt didn't remove that. But yeah, that's... I'm getting into traditional art again because I'm also influenced by Andy Price. He always does traditional art, and he gave me some tips on what materials I should use, and some things I use now is because of him. And so I guess you can blame Andy Price for me getting back into traditional artwork again.
Well, you can blame him. So funny that you mentioned Andy, because I met him personally, and if you don't really know James's OC...
Oh, no, Norman. Why are you always trying to make this about myself? Shut up. We're talking about Citra here.
Yeah, I know, but this is just fascinating because everyone who knows James knows that he's the mod blog for Us Movie Slate. And everyone who draws Movie Slate says this: I love drawing Movie Slate, but oh god, that main is so hard. Mm-hmm. And here's another thing. James doubts his art. He says his movie slate is not awesome. And, well, I got a picture, or I got something.
Why, Norman? Why are you doing this?
Because I love torturing you. And Andy said that, well, I'll just link this into the stream. Not into the stream, but into the Skype chats, and yeah, you can take a look, see, and judge for yourself.
Oh, I think I love the scene. Dear James, do not doubt your friend. This is a very cool design for a pony. Hell yeah, that is a cool design. I like it. It's like food ponies and everything. I have an OC that's all about bacon. I didn't design it to be like bacon at first. He just looked like the colors of bacon. I was like, oh, I'm going to call him Pan.
Citra, you drew this with a mouse?
Oh, you looking at the link?
It is amazing. Yeah.
I drew that with a mouse. The photo reference is in the description. It's,
holy crap.
My reference.
Wow. That is... Wow.
How did you do
that? That is insane.
With a mouse.
Well, I do have a skill in mimicking. Having a reference and having to see what the colors and the lighting is supposed to go really helped. And I drew a lot of realism traditionally, so I already knew about how light and shading works before I did my first digital piece. And it was very long process of changing colors manually and using the mouse and changing the size of the mouse. And can you imagine hearing this all day? Like, that's pretty much the mouse.
That's how I started with Illustrator, with a mouse. It hurt my hand for a while until I got a tablet.
Carpal tunnel syndrome. For the
Yay!
Wee!
Ouch, it hurts.
And then this is the first time I did oil painting. It was an eagle.
So, wow. You should do a... Wow, that looks good.
Damn.
That was actually in an art class. That's the only time I actually took actual art lessons. I did mostly self-taught art. Mm. Even though in high school I had art class, it was mostly bell work.
Well, still, that is good, from saying that I don't want to do art to I want to teach myself how to do art.
Mm-hmm.
That is awesome.
Like I said, I need to get back into it. I haven't touched oil paints forever.
Well, it looks like you have motivation to do so now. And the price says you should.
Mm-hmm.
So, what's your inspiration for doing most of your drawings? Because when I take a look-see at most of your galleries, or the one on Tumblr, is usually, I have the new prism color, so I want to try something new. Okay, I do that. And with the bowling challenge, this is a 30-minute thing. So let me try this one.
The bowling ball drawing. So what's the question?
So where do you get your inspiration from?
Most of the inspiration comes from just from what I do day to day and what I like personally. Like one of my favorite drawings, Rainbow Dash, is where she's up in the air, going upside down, and her wings in the foreground and perspective, and people like that. It's became my all over t-shirt design. It's called In the Air, I think. I drew that right after I watched one of my very favorite snowboard documentary videos called Art of Life? No, In the Air Art. I can't remember the name of it. And after I watched that, it was very artistic, and I was like very influenced to draw something in the air. I was like, Rainbow Dash loves being in the air, so I draw that. So I drew in the emotions I had watching the movie, and it became one of my best art pieces. Other types of inspiration I have, I don't know. I just brainstorm while I'm in the shower. I have the best ideas while I'm in the shower.
Don't we all?
Other times, I'm just trying to be spontaneous. Just draw the first thing that comes to my mind, even no matter how dumb it is.
You never know when inspiration is going to hit you. You never expect it. So it changes for everyone. So it's like, never stop doing what you do. You never know what is going to... cause you have a new idea.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I'm taking a look, see another one of your pictures here, and it says Tick 5.
I remember
5.
Now. Oh, movie's sorry? Called Art of Flight. There we go.
Ah, okay. So if anyone who wants to see that documentary, well, take a look.
It's
because
it's good. It's an awesome snow. If you like, love winter sports, it is good.
So I'm taking a look, see at one of your drawings that you did, and it's titled Take 5 Cover for a Fake Changeling the Movie. And I personally read it, and it was really entertaining. So, was this a commission?
Oh, that was part... That was a prize on fan fiction that Obolescence won. And there was a number of artists who was a prize, including H.O. and J.J., and they get to pick, and Obolescence picked me, and I was like, and he's like, can you make a cover art for my fiction, my writing, Changeling the Movie? So I read it, and I liked it, and it was like a comedy, and I drew basically how I saw it, and how I drew basically one scene from the fiction where the changeling was biting a tree because they thought ponies eat trees. because that's the whole reason why they're creating a film. They're trying to study ponies with the excuse that it's a documentary. And
yep.
That was just that was the funny scene. So it was a cover that was, you know, not really, it wasn't a commission. It was like a prize cover art. And I actually have another prize cover coming up for a completely different reason. It's part of a charity. Oh. And I'm like one of the prizes.
Yeah,
it feels weird being on the shelf.
Wow. But still, yay. Talking about posers and amiibos. And amiibos are, well, kind of the Skylanders thingy. And I see here you have a picture called Little Mac versus Big Mac.
Yeah.
So the art style for this one and the color style is a bit different from what I usually see you do. So what's the inspiration for this one?
Yeah, Smash Brothers. And I didn't see anybody make the Little Mac, Big Mac joke. Like, I did it. People were drawing Big Mac as, like, an actual, you know, like, actually bigger than Little Mac. But mm-hmm. I was thinking, you know, it'd be funnier. They keep the size proportions accurate. And the names are completely opposite. Little Mac, but he's bigger than Big Mac. And I was like, let's have them fight against each other. Though it's been a long time since I've drawn humans, so my anatomy's a little off, though not that much. Mm. And so I need to get back into drawing people again. So that's why I would have made it as a print at Everfree. Was it Everfree? I can't remember my last convention.
Nightmare Nights?
Nightmare Nights. Yeah, that was it. Nightmare Nights. I would have had it at Nightmare Nights, but I was not happy with the posing of the leg. You know, it was off. But move on.
Oh, cool. So I'm guessing you have a 3DS or a Wii U?
Both. I have both games now.
Yay!
I'll get new too when it comes January.
How is the Wii U? Now, completely unrelated question to art, but I need to know. How is the Wii U and is it worth the price of...
The game controller. The game pad sucks as a controller.
I knew it.
The controller options is everywhere, and I'm using the Wii U, the remote and nunchuck combination with motion. I love being able to swing, and the character swings in that direction. I love the idea that you can use GameCube controllers. I have my original GameCube controller still. I just need the adapter they're selling off. And the amount of content they have on the Wii U version is a ton. There's a lot of interesting features for the Wii U version. In fact, they made a video on Nintendo saying 100 new features with Wii U.
Oh god!
Craziest thing is like the 8-player Smash.
Yeah. Oh god, that's so cool.
Yeah, I saw the 8-player Smash videos, and they look that is insane. That is impossible.
You need a big TV.
Yeah. Oh man, Citra, you, me, and James, we need to have a game.
Dude, when I
Charizard.
Little Mac.
I'm going with Pikachu because he's my guy to go to. Been using Pikachu since the Smash Bros. In the Nintendo 64, and I am not changing it.
Oh, Little Mac for me, man. That guy can swerve and ooh, man.
You know that Little Mac has the lowest rate of victories on the Nintendo on the online Nintendo thing. You know?
Yeah, because nobody knows how to use him.
No, it's all your fault, Norman. All the losses are yours.
Hey.
If someone could revive the My Little Pony fighting is magic and apply it to Wii U controller Wii U control setups. I would love. I can finally play it. I tried using it, but I just like. I can't play it.
it was released finally. Somebody picked it up and they said, "Oh, we're just gonna finish the game here and there, making the main six playable." And there you go.
Oh, I know.
And they released it. Yeah,
I know about that version, but I'm just like the controls, the keyboard controls, and everything. I couldn't figure it out.
I'm waiting for main six to release the video game that they were doing with Lauren Faust.
Oh, yeah,
we
yeah,
still
yeah.
haven't heard anything know. From them.
I don't even know if that's even going still. But then again, actual video games takes years.
Uh-huh. That's true.
Yeah. Besides, they want to keep it in secret. They don't want to, like, release it and Hasbro say... They cannot say anything anymore because they are making a new, completely different IP.
Mm-hmm.
They are using different new characters and all that, but...
Really,
yeah.
It really benefits Lauren if it pushes her new concept ideas out.
And she's also going to be making a movie. She's making Medusa for mm-hmm. DreamWorks, was it?
No,
was it?
Disney.
Disney? Disney? Really?
Sony.
Sony.
No, it was Sony, yeah. Sony Animations.
Good for her. It's good that she's not... It's just good that she's not dwelling on the past.
Mm-hmm. It is good that she's not getting stuck. The only ones that are getting stuck are those that... I don't like change! There's something wrong with the house!
but still... wow, where do we even go now? We almost touch almost on everything.
No, I do have one more thing to say. I like always, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When I'm around, then Norman is gonna have to edit the episode and he's gonna go crazy. Citra, for those aspiring artists and those of us who just get down every now and then, or they are not happy with what they're doing, what word of advice would you give?
Draw with passion. Draw what you like. If you're trying to improve yourself, make sure you use references and photo references. Don't draw what you don't know what it is. Don't make it up. Practice when you can. Don't force yourself to practice when you can't. Don't be afraid to fail at a drawing. Don't compare yourself to other artists because there's just a variety of them out there. And just be confident in yourself. There's definitely times when you'll feel down with your artwork. I have many times. Many of my friends do as well, including very well-known, talented artists, even more talented than me. They get down with their artwork. It's time to time. I recommend using tutorial sites like controlpaint.com. That's like control, like the button on your keyboard, CTRL. controlpaint.com. Yeah, that guy has an amazing video library that has a lot of tips on how to draw and theory and everything. I'm even doing some tutorials on my own. Like, I've done line art tutorial and I did a painting of the hair realistically tutorial, and I'm planning one in the future where I do a live covering the basics of covering the most common digital art mistakes that beginning artists always do, including myself when I started. like, for example, like using the dodge and burn tool to shade. Don't do that. Or...
Oh, God, that. Oh.
Or color picking a reference photo for colors. That doesn't work. Or... shading monochromatically, going up and down on the grayscale for coloring. You don't do that. You need to apply different colors together. You know, just basic things that beginning artists falls into and they may do for years before finally realizing they've been doing it wrong. And then my video will definitely help pretty much save beginning artists a huge amount of time with the tips I'll be providing in that video.
Awesome.
Thank you so much. That is actually really good. Thank you. Mm. And, oh, one more thing. Definitely, this is just, I swear, the last thing.
Mm-hmm.
Your Om Nom Nom rarity picture was amazing.
Oh, man,
my favorite picture of yours.
I might have made a little creepy with my realistic style, but
no, dude, it is great. Seriously, like I am looking at it right now. This is brilliant. I am as much as I like Rarity, I like her more when she's suffering. So this picture is just perfect for me.
Oh, you. So I see you have a YouTube here, and your YouTube is mostly for
time lapses.
So wow, I see you have a lot of followers and a lot of viewers, and your time-lapse video seems to be really awesome.
Yeah, definitely. I'm very surprised how well my time-lapse videos has been going on YouTube. If you look at the statistics, like my best one, the My Little Pony spots, that's 2 years old now, and it hit 2 million views not that long ago. I'm like, how did that happen? Where all together, all my YouTube videos together, if you count all the views together, YouTube says I have 5.7 million views.
Wow, statistics. I wish I knew math.
Yeah, if only I put in Google Ads. No.
Well, yeah, no comment there because... no comment there. I'm not going to touch that one. Legal's going to come down on me, so no. Not going to touch that one.
I imagine if I implemented ads on my YouTube videos, they'd probably be mostly Hasbro.
Oh, God, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I know I've been hit by the season 5 trailers on random videos already.
What?
Yeah, like I was going to watch a Minecraft animated video, and there was a Fluttershy season 5 trailer.
What?
Before the video.
Oh, my.
Google knows what you like.
Oh, God, no.
Google knows you like horses.
Tiny horses at that.
Tiny little horses.
Google doesn't know Jack. If Google knows what I like and love, why don't I see potato ads left and right?
I love advertisements. I like, since I work with freelancing and especially television type ones like Cartoon Network, I see Disney's making an advertisement for their toy line of Minnie Mouse and has ponies.
Oh, yeah.
And then right after that, Equestria Girls.
Yay.
I'm like, well, that's coincidental.
Totally not target to this audience. Totally not.
But yeah, I'm doing more with my YouTube channel.
Awesome, awesome. So this is going to be the last question for this session. And what's your next convention?
Probably be Big Apple PonyCon. I'm going to be hosting a panel there, teaching how to draw something. I don't know yet. But I'm going to be doing a panel there, teaching people how to draw. Or paint, or whatever the topic is. Okay. I'm going to try to plan it out, make it as special as it can. Mm-hmm. So it's just not like, you draw a line here, I'm not going to explain why. That kind of thing. And I'm going to try to record it so people can watch it online later. Mm-hmm. And offer probably a download video, or private videos for those at the events where private links only for them. So like, hey, thanks for you for coming. Here's some special videos just for you guys. Awesome. And it'd be like more tips or something or follow-ups. So I'm going to try and make it as special as I can. But I can't wait to go to Big Apple PonyCon. If it's at the same venue like it was last time at the hotel. Because I know just a couple blocks walk distance, there's a pizza restaurant called My Little Pizzeria.
Oh, God, that's so cool.
Well, that is so perfect.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah, I'm definitely eating here every time I come.
Awesome.
And the pizza's awesome, so that works.
Do they sell little pizzas too?
No, they're pretty big.
Oh, wow.
It's they have an old cash register with the raised buttons.
Wow. Oh my God, like, that's really old.
Yeah.
That is so cool. So, well... if anyone else has any questions before I end this, ask them now before we move on.
I got a question for the first time in the history of our podcast.
Yay!
Yes, finally, you have a personality. Go ahead, use it.
Not funny. Anyway, do you admire or look up to any artists out there?
I say I'm still looking up to and admiring the first artists that got me into art. That would be my own art teacher. She's retired now. I'll also say Imagine, that is I-M-A-G-I-N-E-E. She also goes by the name Mattel, I think. Anyways, she does amazing traditional realism artwork of people and portraits. It is outstanding. She really pushed me into studying realism art with pencils. And, oh man, you'd have no idea how amazing detail work she does. Like, she did a portrait commission of a couple who got recently married. And you see the vibrant smiles of them just about going for a kiss. And if you look closely, you can even see the raised goosebumps on the woman's neck because of the nervousness and how excited she is. She was able to draw those details in. Oh man, it's just amazing. And other artists, Mac Polenta, MacPulenta. He doesn't do much artwork now, but he did a lot of time-lapse art on YouTube. He has some of the oldest time-lapse arts. If you look speed painting, you still find his artwork pop up, and he does some amazing, realistic, highly detailed digital artwork. Like, he did like Spider-Man, and you can see the threads in his suits, or he did Bumblebee from the new Transformers series, and it looks exactly like this from the movies, and that got me into creating time-lapse arts, and that's how I started doing time-lapse art. So those are my three main inspirations and people who pretty much I can blame for getting me pushed into traditional art and digital art. And I guess you can say Andy Price is my more recent inspiration for getting me back into traditional art and considering more into line comic style artwork. So influence is everywhere, and even though sometimes it gets me down, like how well they do their artwork, I try to turn that into inspiration, and I just try to learn how to do what they do and move and push forward with my art career. Because with painting and drawing, with art, you'll never perfect it. You'll never be 100% perfect with art. You'll always be improving. There's always something to improve at. And that's why I love to draw. I love to paint. It's because this is always a challenge each time I draw.
Awesome.
That's awesome. That's just awesome, man.
That's so proving further that you don't need to have just one inspiration, one source to inspire. You can have many.
And with that, thank you, Citra, for answering all of our questions.
I can't wait for Rainbow Dash's solo song in season 5.
Oh, yeah.
They're
so good.
I've always been hoping for a solo since season 1, and I never got it, but I can't wait for it.
The closest we got was the pet song in season 2, which was
so that
really
was
good.
A duet.
Yeah, but still.
That was a duet. Yeah, that was the closest we got to a Rainbow Dash focused song.
Or maybe in Quest to Your Girls Rainbow Rocks, where she says, I'm awesome, but that's
I didn't watch the movie yet. Don't say it.
Saying the name of the song does not spoil it.
You have no idea how far my imagination can go.
Oh, then you're going to be...
I know nothing of... I go very far, and as in
it goes like this. I'm awesome. No, I'm kidding.
I thought it was something like, I'm really awesome. Nope.
No, she goes all girly. No, that's not her.
I did hear, however, that everybody gets out of that movie saying, damn, Rainbow Dash is a jerk. It's like, yeah, so is show Rainbow Dash. I'm sorry, did you discover that gravity is a thing?
The characters will always have the same issues because, you know, just like people like us, even though we may learn our lesson and stuff like that, we're still doing the same mistakes.
True. And
exactly.
Technically,
look at me, I'm still being Spanish. That is a mistake.
And technically, for the record, Movie Rainbow Dash and Pony Rainbow Dash are two totally separate characters.
Sure, it sure feels like that because they had different goals.
So, anyway, Citra, thank you for coming on and answering all our silly and random questions. So, where can they find you, the audience who are listening to this now? Where can they find you online?
Well, let me take a quick look here. And yep, that works. You just search. You just Google my name, tsitra360. That's tsitra360. That's artist spells backwards, by the way. He's a way to remember. Yep.
Citra.
And with just Google, it pops up my Tumblr, my YouTube, even my tags on Derby Burrell, Twitter, Wheel of Fine, Facebook, my original DeviantArt, my live stream. It seems like everything's there. If you just Google tsitra360, you can find whatever social poison you have and follow me.
And yes, if... just gave you a follow right there, man.
Yeah, and if people... my computer literally just chimed. As soon as you hit that button. Yeah, it says, are you Authredistum?
Yeah, Authredistum, that's me.
Yep, Authredistum is now following you, and you have a logo of a phoenix bird, I think.
Yeah, it's an Articuno's head seen from the side. It's the silhouette of an Articuno's head.
Okay, so yeah, follow me, and I'll be chimed when you do, so give me a chime.
This is on what, on the Twitters or on the Tumblrs? Because I already followed you. How would they have that chime? Chilino. And whoever's too lazy to type it in, I'll just link it everything to show notes. And this just hit me dab center in my head. Like, your name is artist spelled backwards. Like, I did not saw that.
It still blows people's minds. Some people's been a fan of mine for like 3-5 years, and then I say my name is artist spelled backwards. They're like, they get upset with themselves. They get overly upset with themselves. They never realize it.
Oh god, it's like,
but it is super simple. How can you not know it's artist spelled backwards?
James, people don't really read names backwards. Like, I try to read your name backwards is Namron or Ziamatch. That's Jamesy. And Ron, that's easy, Nor.
But still, oh god, I feel a bit smarter and dumber at the same time. Yay.
Yeah, I make a joke whenever some people calls me a god in art. I'm like, so you're calling me a dog? I'm a dog artist.
Wow. Yes, this is Doge.
Dog mode activated.
Too bad I didn't call myself Citra Dog.
Oh, got artist. But anywho, thank you, Citra, for. Oh, thank you, Art. Oh, God, this is not going to be the. Anyway, Citra, thank you for coming on. And, wow, I'm mind blown. Mind blown. So, anywho, would you be able to join us for the next topic, which is news time?
Oh, no, I'm going to have to be getting some breakfast here and start my day.
Alrighty then. Anyway, Citra, thank you for coming on and being an awesome guest, man.
Thank you, and I'll be sure to link the podcast once it's left to my fans, so maybe you'll get a few more, maybe you get 10, 20, 50 more views out of that.
Oh, thank you, and thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for being so kind to put up with my stupidity. And
mine.
I apologize in advance if I said anything that might have offended you or pissed you off. I am usually like that.
And to any of my fans listening in, be sure to follow these guys' podcasts. They're awesome. So see you guys next time.
Yep. And you're most welcome to come back again, man. You've been an awesome guest. And that name, oh god, I still...
Artists.
I know. Anyway, we'll see you.
See ya.
Have a good one, Citra.
Mm-hmm.
You too, Jamesy.
May the balls be with you.
So anyway, Rom, it's your time to shine.
News time. I am Romuald with the MBS Show News Time, and in today's News Time, possibly more MotPie in Season 5. Ingrid Nilsson, the voice actress for MotPie, received a question on her Twitter asking her if MotPie is part of the Apple family. Her response was, all will be revealed soon. Links can be found in the show notes below.
So, yeah, more MotPie.
Oh my goodness, so that is such a silly question. It's obvious, if Pinky's the cousin and Mot's her sister, of course she's part of the Apple family.
But they never did say anything about...
you don't need to say anything. It's obvious. It's a family tree, man. It's obvious. It's right there.
James, what do you have to say, man?
Well, they did mention that we were going to see Pinkie Pie's family in season 5, so it only makes sense that we see Maud in it. I mean, we're gonna see Marvel and Lime are the names of the other sisters, mm-hmm. right? Marvel okay. and Lime, and we're gonna see her parents finally. Mm-hmm. We'll figure out if they don't like magic and witches, and if they're going to put Twilight in the bonfire and set it on fire or something like that. I don't know, but it's going to be fun. Something tells me that it's going to be a fun episode when they clash.
Oh man, I can't wait. Personally, for me, Mod Pie is one of those. I was iffy at first, but looking at her again, it's like, oh my, she's iffy because she doesn't fit the pony stereotype.
I wouldn't call it the best episode of the season. I would call it one of the most interesting ones, though. But that's because it relies heavily on the character of Mod Pie and all that. So yeah,
I would say that it's an interesting way to introduce a character. It's an interesting way to introduce a character. It's a total gamble. And some people say it worked, some people say it didn't. And, well, the majority say it did. So, yeah. But we still don't know if Maud is an apple or not.
We do!
If Pinkie Pie is an apple, there is a relation going on right there.
That's what I just said!
Shut up, Drum. Nobody cares for your opinion.
We're doing a podcast. We're not creating the internet here.
Didn't you miss me, guys? Didn't you miss me? Aha! I did. Are you not entertained?
I guess we are. But anywho, let's move on to the next news. And Rom.
And next news, Cloudsdale Splash, Singapore's first MLP theme art festival. For most bronies, the opportunity to go to a My Little Pony theme convention is rare, especially for bronies who live in the Southeast Asia. But now the opportunity is within reach with Cloudsdale Splash. Cloudsdale Splash is a Singapore-based event. It's a two-day play, December 20 and 21st, art festival happening at the IMM Garden Plaza. Event starts at 1:30 p.m. and admission is free of charge. Be sure to bring your art supplies and have fun. Links can be found in the show notes below.
Yep. If you're, well, kind of close to Singapore or live in Singapore, be sure to attend this con. Or not really con, but event. And have fun, guys, because we just talked to Citra and he says a lot of good things about art. And this is an event where you can do art and people will teach you art. So this will be awesome. James and Rom, as residential artists, what do you have to say about this event, man?
I'm still left out of the action.
More power to them.
More power to them. But if something like this happens in your place, would you join it?
Well, first of all, I would squee for 3 days straight.
Wow.
Lose my sanity.
Okay.
Get all my gear up and be the first one in line. I'll freaking sleep next to the entrance before it even opens. I'll get a tent. I'll set up camp.
I would go there, but not to participate, but more for to learn.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I don't consider myself good enough to participate in the contest. So I will be there just looking.
No, technically it's no contest.
Learning and all that. Mm. Yeah, but I mean, I will be like... It's. I don't think I should be there drawing, but I should be there learning.
That is also a good thing because, like Sitra just said, he still needs to study more. And, well, even you, Rom, and even myself, if we're going to do art, we need to learn more because whatever we have is not enough.
That's not good enough.
Indeed.
Never.
Mm-hmm. But anyway, it's not only art, there's also music. If you want to learn how to play or produce music, there's also a music lesson there. And guess what? Our buddy, Daniel Anthony, is one of the person in charge. So, yeah, if you...
Is he?
Yeah, he is. You don't sound happy. You okay there, James?
Grumble. Next topic, please.
But anywho.
I have been Romeo with MBS Show News. Back to you, Norman.
Yeah, thanks.
Wait a minute, is that it?
Yep, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Did nothing else happen?
Well, nothing in particular. If you have anything else to add, James, please do say so.
I just have a... I cannot believe that... Has that... What are half of the Poston Equestria really then? Just girlfriend and pole stuff? What the hell?
Well, and merchandise.
My God.
We're here to bring the news, not to sell or market stuff.
Indeed.
Bloody hell.
I try my best, James.
I would cause a riot in my town to make an international news line, but I was too lazy.
Your best wasn't good enough, Norman.
Oh, I feel...
Give him some time, and the show's on hiatus. There's not much going on. Everyone's taking five, doing other stuff, you know, catching their breath, because I feel the next season's going to be a big bang, if not less.
In unrelated news, the MLP CCG Crystal game set is officially released, so if you play the card games, there's that. So, do you, James, play the card game? No, right? Yes.
No, I do have a lot of cards, because one of my buddies got me a bunch of My Little Pony cards when we were at back 2014. I have an entire tin full of My Little Pony cards. But here's the problem, because I have no idea how to play the game. I have no idea how to build a deck. So, I have a bunch of cards, but I have no idea what to do with all of them. And I am here sitting on those cards saying, what am I going to do with all of these cards?
Well, funny enough that you mentioned that. A while back we talked to one of the judge who judged the game, and he gives a lot of tips on how to, well, technically play rules, and a good place to find tips on how to, well, basically do anything with the card game. So if you want to, well, learn how to, it's in the show notes. I'll try and link it into the show notes on where you can learn how to play the card games.
I guess I could try that, yeah.
And if you want the game with me, James, I have a way to, well, technically stream or webcam it. We can play, I can teach you.
I'm not sure. I'll have to look into that.
Mm-hmm. And by the way, the guy's name is Grandpa's. Yep, my memory's so shot up. That's what, I'm getting old.
You're stupid today.
Aww.
You woke up with the stupid on today. That's fine. I wake up with the stupid today every day. I know how you feel.
Aww.
I'm always stupid.
Shut up, Ron.
Don't be mean to Ron.
Shut up, Norman.
Aww. But anywho, shoutouts. My shoutout goes to Citra and you guys. Thank you for being on, and thank you for making this show entertaining. And what about you, James? Any shoutouts to give out to?
Well, I want to give a shout-out to the people on my streams, that whenever they show up, they are really cool, and they're very helpful, and they give a good amount of feedback. And speaking of feedback, I want to give a shout-out to Glenn Skunk. He's a good buddy of mine, very good artist, and he gives me a lot of feedback on my artwork. He helps me get the anatomy right whenever it's wrong, and fix my mistakes. And I want to give a shout-out to Sketchy, because Sketchy Sounds, of course, from Everfree Network. Because he's a great guy, and very very few times we acknowledge how great of a guy he is. And of course, give a shout out to Wilson, because if he is still listening to this podcast with the frequency that he says he does, then he might be listening to this right now. So
thank
give a shout out to
Will.
Him as well. There you go. That's it.
If you're listening to this, Will, please tweet me or drop me a line on the Skypes and tell me how silly I am, because I feel on this episode I am really silly. And Ro, what about you?
Shout out to all the people who visited my stream last night. Thank you. You were such a wonderful crowd. And hi, Mom!
Okay.
Always with the mom. You have a problem.
I love my mom.
Yeah,
how many
definitely
parents
have a
out there do you know that support their children no matter how crazy their idea is?
True that. Well, we
I have the craziest of all ideas, but my mother still loves me and supports me all the way.
Well, true that. We had Citra, so that also counts too.
I bet if I even turned homosexual, she'd still be okay with it.
Moving on. Anyway, if you have any questions, concerns, or suggestions for the show, you can contact us at mbsshow@gmail.com. And if you'd like to email us personally, you can reach us. Well, links will be in the show notes. And you can contact the show on Twitter. The show's Twitter account is @mbsshow. CityBot will Suji, but we'll do a lot of stuff related to the show.
Surely does it once a week, man.
Oh, you think that, don't you? She needs more upgrades. Anyway, you can reach me at Norman Sanzo. I tweet about toys, food, and whatever tickles my fancy. And recently I went to Singapore and got a few stuff. Bought a few boosters. Didn't get nothing. And on the way home, I met this one brony who works at a restaurant. So, yay! Shoutouts to him. And I'll be visiting that restaurant some more. Awesome. And James, where can they reach you, man?
Well, you guys can find me on Twitter on at James lowercase cork. You can find my DeviantArt on jamescork.deviantart.com, and you can check Movie Slate's Ask Pony Tumblr on askmovieslate.tumblr.com. As per usual, things haven't changed yet.
Mm-hmm. And be sure to check under your beds, just in case.
And Ro, what about you?
You can find me at my reliciousgallery.tumblr.com or on my Deviant, reliciousdeviant.com.
Awesome, awesome. And also, please subscribe and rate us on iTunes, YouTube, and Stitcher Radio. And also like our Facebook page. Yes, we have the Facebooks. You can also catch us on PonyVerLife.com. And if you're listening to this on YouTube, please press the like button and favorite. Anyway, I have been Norman Sanzo.
And I have been James Cork.
And I am Romeo Wald.
And as artists, we must improve. As a podcaster, I must be smarter. Isn't that right, James?
I'm sorry, what? I couldn't hear you over the sound of your stupidity.
We'll see you next week, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Have a good one.